when you talk about the channels only thing, I remember a while back, I was thinking about how I didn't want to pull the window for the world to see, a window that would like sometimes have a reflection off of it, but you could see through it and see me. I wanted to hold a mirror so that when people looked at it, it reflected the sun, it reflected what God, but they couldn't see through it to see me. So, one morning I was reading 1 Thessalonians a couple months ago, and I was thinking, this is such an amazing chapter to motivate missionaries. Like, if I ever went and talked about Bolivia or I talked to the missions conference, I would talk about 1 Thessalonians. And like 2 days later, Karen called out of like completely out of the blue. And so I felt like this is really what God was leading me to share this morning. And I think it's funny because I keep, what I have planned is like what you guys keep talking over and over. It's like a God theme in our weekend and how he keeps the same thing coming back to us. And it reminded me of one thing that I heard once, that we need to preach the gospel to ourselves every day. And that even if you're already a Christian, you still need to hear the gospel over and over to solidify that, to motivate you, to bring you back to your foundation. I think to start out, before we start reading 1 Thessalonians, I would like to just give you some context. And you probably already know this, but let's just have fun with Paul's life. So Paul is persecuting Christians. He is looking for ways to kill Christians. And he's walking on the road to Damascus. And boom, he sees a great light. And he's blinded. And he hears a voice from heaven. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he's like, who are you, Lord? And you know the story. And so God sends Ananias to talk to Paul, Saul. And he's converted. He has a huge heart to reach out, and he's called to reach the Gentiles. Now, if I were Paul, and I had just been persecuting the Jews, the Jewish Christians, I think that I would want to just do a little work on the side for the Jewish Christians to kind of make up for the persecutions that I had done. I think I would want to, I know God called me to work with the Gentiles, but I feel so bad for what I did to the Jewish Christians that I'm just going to go convert a bunch of Jewish Christians and make that my mission. I like to think of myself sometimes, and this is not right, but I like to think of myself as like part of the quadrinity. You've heard of the Trinity, right? Well, I like to think of myself as part of the quadrinity. I'm like the advisor to God, and I like to kind of tell him how I want my life mission to go. And so I'm learning to that I'm not the advisor to God. There's not a quadrinity. It's only a Trinity. And so I'm really excited about Paul's story, and because he definitely follows God in spite of a lot of persecution, and he keeps following God in spite of like continuing persecution. It's pretty sure, although there's always arguing that the Thessalonian church, when Paul went and wrote this letter, it was the first church he went to and on his missions. So after he's converted, and he is trained with the disciples, and he feels led, the first place he goes is this church. And he makes it in the Thessalonian church Thessalonica, in the city of Thessalonica, three weeks or a month before he's kicked out. So in that time, he develops such a heart for the new believers. He talks about them as like his children, him as like the nurse that takes care of them or the mother that takes care of them, just to see his huge heart for this church. And I was hoping that someone would like to read 1 Thessalonians 1 all the way through chapter 2, verse 4. So someone that likes to read could read that for us. So just again to say, so Paul went to Thessalonica, and he's there about 3 weeks or maybe a month, and then he's kicked out in great opposition. And he goes on more missionary tours. Just as Paul, he goes to prison, he witnesses to the prison guard. Well, he gets kicked out, and he goes to Philippi, and he goes to the other churches. And when he meets up with Timothy again. He sends Timothy back to this church. And Timothy comes back and says, they're doing well. They're growing. Their faith has spread throughout the whole region. And Paul is so excited, he writes this letter in response to Timothy's coming back and reporting. So that's where this letter is coming from. And when we read this, especially when we get to chapters 3 and 4, you're going to hear Paul's just excitement that this church survived. Like, I'm sure we all know that when we put things in God's hands and you turn away, like, I'm sure by Paul and his human nature was like, I don't know, without me, are they going to make it? And he hears back that they did, and he's just so overwhelmed with joy. So, who is a good reader and enjoys reading and would read that for us? All right, Joanna, thank you so much.
Paul and Silvanus and Timotheus unto the church of the Thessalonians, which is in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power, and in the Holy Ghost, and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. And ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Ghost. So that ye were ensamples to all who believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place where your faith to Godward is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything. For they themselves show of us what manner of entering in ye had unto you, and how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. For yourselves, brethren, know our entrance in unto you, that it was not in vain. But even after that we had suffered before and were shamefully entreated, as you know, at Philippi, we were bold in our God to speak unto you the gospel of God with much contention. For our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of uncleanness, nor in guile. But as you were allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God, which trieth our hearts.
Paul goes to share the gospel under great opposition because that is where God led him. And perhaps God will lead some of us to go places where there is great opposition. And we will be challenged to spread the gospel there. But I think that wherever we are is our mission field. And although God may call us somewhere to some difficult place to share the gospel, to spread the word, I think it's important that we keep in our focus that right here is our mission field. I know I just came off the mission field after many years, and I've had a more difficult transition than I anticipated. And I've had to put in my mind that being a chiropractor is a mission field. That whatever we do, we are a missionary. And the people that we cross paths with every day, that is our mission field. And I think we see that very well in Paul's life. Like when he went to prison, and he's like, oh great, I'm in prison, a new mission field. Like everywhere he went, he's like, oh, a new mission field, wherever God had him. And we can really see how much Paul cared about the growth of his spiritual children and Paul's passion to see the kingdom growing in the people around him. If we look at 1 Thessalonians 2:4, and it talked about how they speak as men entrusted with the gospel, I think Paul really clearly saw his mission. And I think it's important for us as Christians to have a clear mission in front of us. And so my first application point that I kind of want to pull from this is, what is your life passion? What is your life mission? What is your life vision? I'm going to challenge us this morning to kind of put in writing in front of us, and someone challenged me when I was 17 to do this, to write like a life vision statement or a life verse. Something in front of us that can be tangible, that every day when we wake up, we can, and it's going to be a summary of the Bible. It's going to be a, It's going to be like Paul saying, I was a man entrusted with the gospel. As you can see in the progression of Paul's letters, he becomes a servant of Christ. He becomes a slave of Christ, a slave of the gospel. He sells himself out for the gospel. He's clear on his mission. When I was in Bolivia, I picked a mission verse, a verse that I asked people to pray when I was on the mission field, and it happens to be 1 Thessalonians 4:1, and it talks about the things that you are doing, do more and more. And I stole that idea from, I don't know if some of you know the Van Gogh family, from their grandma, Janet Brown, and I would go have breakfast with her, and she would pray over me. And one day I said, she was old as the hills, and I said, Janet, what's the secret to being, you know, what's your secret to having this flourishing Christian life? And she said, well, I don't know what to tell you, but one thing I always do is pray for more ministry. And so that was how I chose that more and more, to just keep, okay, God, here I am, please bring more. Okay, thank you for what I get to do, but help me to be able to do more. I had a friend in Bolivia named Allie, and Allie came down as a two-year teacher at the Christian school, and she was like a high school, I think she was science teacher. She had a guitar strapped on her back, bare feet, kind of a hippie type person. And she walked around hugging everyone. And everywhere she went, she was like, I love you, man. This is, like, just love oozed out of her. And I was like, what is up with this Allie? And we started praying together, being like prayer partners. And we went for walks around the neighborhood. And she told me at one of our walks, that she had made it her life mission to show the love of God to every person she met. So every person she encountered, she did that. Like, that was what her, every day she woke up, God, how can I show your love to every person I meet? And she was the most loving person I ever met because she was right on a mission. When I was in college, I read a book by Henry Blackaby called Experiencing God. And he says, find out where God is at work around you and join him. Like right where you're at in your day, where is God working around you? And whose hearts are open? And join God where he is at. I also read The Purpose-Driven Life. I think it talks about examining your spiritual shape, your spiritual gifts, your hearts, your ability, your personalities, and your experience. Putting that all together, where you are at, and being able to serve in that spiritual shape. So when I told you when I was 17 that I was challenged to write a mission statement, well, I wrote, to be a shining godly servant everywhere I went. I later on added humble, because I felt like it was too prideful to be a shining godly servant. And I picked my life verse, Isaiah 53:3, which is then repeated in Hebrews 12:12, where it says, wherefore lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but rather be healed. And I was challenged at that point that the disabled wouldn't stay lame, but that I would bring healing. So I thought we could just take a few minutes in our hearts and just start to brainstorm right where you're at, something that you can put a life verse, a challenging thought in your head every day, but to keep it biblical, to keep it God-focused. So spend just a minute where you're at right now, just thinking through that, and if you have any ideas that God gives you, something to be praying about. been thinking a little bit about how God has led me. And I remember a really quick version of my testimony is I prayed to receive Christ when I was 6 years old because I first understood God's love through my parents and just the Christian church and the Christian environment I was living in. And I understood God's love as a six-year-old child did. And when I got to be 12 or 13, I thought that my family was not having very much fun. I thought that my life was stifled. I saw other kids doing things that I thought were more fun, watching movies that I couldn't watch, playing games that I couldn't play. So I kind of went through a rebellious time. And I remember being at a football game, and I was trying to have fun the worldly way, and it left me really empty. And I was walking home from that football game across Fall Creek, and I looked up and I saw the sky, and the stars were amazing. One of those fall nights, you know, when you just see everything. And I thought, you know what? That is where life is at. And I remember when it says 1 John, he who has the Son of God has life. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, he who doesn't have the Son of God doesn't have life. And I was looking for this life, and I found it in God. And I felt God speak to my heart that I was his child, that he loved me. And after that, I'm like, okay, I'm going to follow you. And that's when I really started reading my Bible every day. And I'll tell you, if you don't have a regular time with God every day, that is really revolutionary in your life. It really changed my life. I was starting to just every day for myself seek God. But because I'm a poor learner, and it took twice to learn it, when I was in college, I thought I needed to have a boyfriend, and I thought I needed to do some of the college things that people do. And again, I came to this time I was even lower. This time, instead of just being on the ground, I was digging a hole and climbing in my own hole. And finally, I came to the bottom of the hole, and I couldn't throw the dirt out. And I finally looked up. I'm like, okay, now I'm going to look up. And I said, okay, now I'm going to live for you. And when I was 19, I really dedicated my life to service for God. And so I thought, okay. And at the time, I was pre-med. I was going to be a medical doctor. And I thought, you know what? I need to be a youth pastor, because that is how you serve God. I love kids. It's perfect. I'll be a Sunday school teacher. I'll work with the youth group. I'll be in ministry. So I started out in this youth training program. And 3 days into the program, I felt like that wasn't what I was supposed to do. I felt God say, no, I want you to go to chiropractic college. And my parents are chiropractors. And I don't know if you've ever experienced, I'm the oldest child. If you've ever experienced this, I'll do anything except what my parents do. I want to do the opposite of what my parents do. I want to do what my parents are like. So I was like, oh, I don't know, God. Chiropractor, that's the one thing I don't. I want to be a farmer or a mailman, but I don't want to be a chiropractor. But I felt led. And so I went to chiropractic college. And it was there where I learned about chiropractic missions. And I ended up as a chiropractor on the mission field. But while I was at chiropractic college, when you're a chiropractor, you can't be a regular missionary. You have to be an undercover missionary. So every day I'd go to school, and I know this is dorky, but I'd put my little sunglasses on, and I would turn the corner and be like, dun, 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 dun. And I was like, okay, I'm here. How can I serve you, God? I'm your servant. And I would babysit for people, and I found many ways to do ministry. And a lot of my friends from chiropractic college have since then said, I remember we were telling dirty jokes one day, and you walked away. Someone messaged me on Facebook. They found me, and they're like, I just want you to know that really made an impact in my life. Or little things that sometimes when God sends you on a different path than what you expect, but if you serve him where you're at, you find the joy and the reward in that. So I need another brave reader who will continue our reading of 1 Thessalonians.
I can do it.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, Karen.
Picking up where now?
It's going to be 1 Thessalonians 2 and then just verses 7 to 20.
Okay. But we were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherisheth her children. So, being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you were dear unto us. For you remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day, because we would not be chargeable unto any of you, we preached unto you the gospel of God. Ye are witnesses, and God also, how holily and justly and unblameably we behaved ourselves among you that believe. as ye know how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you, as a father doth his children, that ye would walk worthy of God, who hath called you unto his kingdom and glory. For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. For ye, brethren, became followers of the churches of God, which in Judea are in Christ Jesus. For ye also have suffered like things of your own countrymen, even as they have of the Jews, who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets, and have persecuted us, and they please not God, and are contrary to all men, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins alway. For the wrath is come upon them to the uttermost. But we, brethren, being taken from you for a short time in presence, not in heart, endeavored the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? For ye are our glory and joy.
I think when we look at how Paul evangelized, how he lived out when he said, he feels like a man approved by God, entrusted with the gospel. How he lived out the gospel is a good biblical principle for us. He lived out the gospel by living it out in front of the people. He didn't go on the street corner and preach the gospel and then go back in his house and go on Facebook and look at Pinterest and pick out recipes that he liked. Or he didn't go out on the street corner and hand out tracts and then go back to church and do crafts and hang out with his church people. He lived the gospel. It says, you know what manner of men we were for your sake. I really think fruitful evangelism is sharing your lives as well. It's living it out with people. It's a lifestyle evangelism, or some people call it friendship evangelism. It's a long term. You are in it with the non-believer for the long haul. And I saw a lot of short-term missionaries come and go. I saw a lot of good works be done. I saw people come and build churches. But I felt like the missionaries that made the bigger impact are the ones who set up their house and said, I will live like you live, I will dress like you dress, and I will invite you in to have dinner with me. And that's really, especially if you're in a warm culture where they're friendly and living with each other, that really makes the big difference. Another principle we see is spiritual multiplication. So we go out and preach the gospel, but we also disciple people so that eventually they can share the gospel. So that we're not just handing out tracts and then going back to our kitchens. We're helping people also be able to grow in the Lord and eventually be able to share the gospel. Just in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, we see several verses where the people became followers. And like verse 6, where it's bold, it says, ye became followers of us and of the Lord. And then we were in samples to you that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. And how they followed Paul, and then other Christians were following them. So that like, they're multiplying themselves. And I see that is a biblical principle. Also shown in 2 Timothy 2, 1 and 2, Paul feeds into Timothy, and he tells him, the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit to faithful men who shall also be able to teach others. And I try to do some math multiplying by threes. Let's say in my life I only save three people, but those three people I teach to save three more people. And you can see that just a few generations, and I just did math off the top of my head, it could be wrong. But anyway, so the point is, in just a few generations, 700 people have heard the gospel. And I only shared the gospel with three people. So that's the principle of spiritual multiplication. And I think the real take-home application point is if one of your unbelieving friends becomes a Christian, and you get to spy on that, you get to spy at God's work in their lives, and then you should begin to disciple them. So, application point, where can you start to build intentional relationships with non-believing people? with the purpose of sharing the gospel. And this, you guys have heard this, like we heard this when Laura spoke, and I've heard this in our small group Bible study. You guys are, this is a theme of your week, is to be sharing the gospel when we're in Walmart. Mm-hmm. And we're checking out at Walmart to be, and you guys are already doing this, so. Mm-hmm. But who do you cross paths with regularly? Were your coworkers, your clerks, your relatives, your neighbors? Can you start to build a relationship? I always get gas at the holiday station, and I try to check out with Brenda, because I want to be intentional with Brenda, because God put Brenda on my heart. And so the challenge is that God, we can pray that God will bring more and more opportunities to share his message in a relationship-building type place. Also, like you guys are talking about, when you're smiling and people ask you why you're smiling, to tell them the reason for the hope that you have. And I've heard the practice of giving a blessing, and even the word goodbye, if you look at the root, it was go with God. God be with you. Or in Spanish, adios, go with God. In English, God be with you. When you say goodbye to someone, instead of being like, okay, take care, like implying take care of yourself, instead say, I'll be praying for you, or may you feel God's peace today, or don't forget that we have hope, to leave them with some sort of blessing when you say goodbye to people. And this is good for me as a chiropractor. This is one thing I can do, is every time I'm with a patient, I try somewhere in the meeting to be able to leave them a spiritual blessing. More than just like, okay, you keep your chin up, to be like, I'll be praying that God lifts your head. Sort of like my prayer in college was to be a secret servant agent. And I prayed that I'd be able to move each person one step closer to God. So I think we're going to take a few minutes, again, just maybe 1 minute, to write down, where can you live out your faith where you're at? What can you do? What can you change in your life? How can you pray for more non-Christians to come into your path? So just take a minute. The last application point I have really kind of washes in with this one. They kind of blend together, because you can see that Paul's joy when Timothy reports back to him that the believers he were torn away with are going strong. How Paul treated them like children. And I have a reader that will read 1 Thessalonians 3.
Oh, yeah.
Therefore, when we could bear it no longer, we were willing to be left behind at Athens alone. And we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's co-worker in the gospel of Christ, to establish and exhort you in your faith. Let no one be moved by these afflictions, for you yourselves know that we are destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it has come to pass, and just as you know. For this reason, when I could bear it no longer, I sent to learn about your faith, for fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain. But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us the good news of your faith and love and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live, if you are standing fast in the Lord. For what thanksgiving can we return to God for you, for all the joy that we feel for your sake before our God, as we pray most earnestly night and day that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you. so that you may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints.
The next principle we see is that transition from evangelism to discipleship. How Paul longs to see them grow, and how even from a distance, he's figuring out how he can get back there to finish what they're lacking, to continue to help them grow. And so my third application point and challenge to you is to build some fruitful Christian connections, to find a more mature Christian that you can meet with on a somewhat regular basis, even if you can't meet every week with them, maybe every other week or once a month, and then to find someone that you can disciple, a less mature Christian that you can meet with, a new Christian. And then, of course, to have, like we are for each other, those peers, those prayer partners, accountability partners. That's what we can be for each other. But I want to challenge you, like we see Paul and Timothy, or Eli and Samuel, or Elijah and Elisha, Jesus and the disciples, Jesus and his close group. It's a very biblical principle to work with younger Christians and help them grow in their faith. So to be intentional in your discipleship and finding your people. And you might ask, well, what would we talk about? Well, if they're a baby Christian, maybe you want to go through it like What a Baby Christian Should Know book. Go to the Christian bookstore and find, you know, the 20 basic things every Christian should know book and start going through them, or talk to them about having a regular quiet time, or about what prayer is, or what, you know, the Trinity, some of the basic things. And certainly you could go through a book if you don't want to do it on your own. If you're working with someone who's only a little bit less mature and pretty much knows a lot, like I have some friends that I've been working with for years, and we get together and I'll say, what is God teaching you? What are some themes in your life? How can I be praying for you? Just to bring the conversation to a place where we can talk about meaningful things. I met Helen Van Gore when I babysat her kids, but I asked her to be my mentor, and she was like a second mom to me. And I've had some good Christian mentors in my life. And I highly encourage you, if you aren't meeting with a Christian woman, to find someone. Mrs. Rowe would be amazing. Mrs. Forrester, another amazing, lots of good, I'm sure all your moms, you know, set them up with your friends so you guys can share each other's moms and feed into each other. And then if you don't have a regular prayer partner, to find someone that you can meet with and go for walks with or get coffee every week and encourage each other in the Lord and hold each other accountable. Believe it or not, it is easy. I struggled with an eating disorder when I was in Bolivia, and here I was a missionary. It is easy to fall. And it's good. If I would have had less coming and going in my life and more people watching me, I think that could have been prevented. And I think part of it was I just didn't set up a good support system. So I encourage you all, even if you think, well, you know, I have this Christian family or I have a good church, to still set this up, people who are like, no, I'm going to ask you the hard questions. Why don't we take a minute and you can write these three. If you already have someone who is or who could be your mentor, just answer these three questions in your book, kind of brainstorm some ideas so that we leave with some ideas here. I want to finish by mentioning another theme that I see in 1 Thessalonians is, and in all of Paul's work, is that he pours prayer over everything. And I feel like that's really important in all of our ministry. I feel like that keeps it God-centered. If if I would say, okay, let's make your life vision statement and let's find out who you're going to evangelize and who, you know, who's going to be, who you're going to mentor, who's going to be your disciple. But if we don't keep God in the center, it can become about us. And I know there's been times in my life, like I told you, where I kind of want to be the advisor to God. But I think it's important if I keep my focus on how amazing God is, spend time in worship, to kind of reground myself in the fact that God is really amazing, because it's easy to forget that. Or to lose track of my sinfulness and think, well, I'm not as bad as other people in the culture. You know, I haven't murdered anyone. But instead to really keep prayer on everything. Lots of verses in 1 Thessalonians that talk about how Paul is praying. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. In everything gives thanks. 17, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So just to summarize our take-home message, to live your life with a spiritual purpose. Don't just go about your days without thinking that you have something that day that God has given you to do to grow the kingdom, to glorify his name. And whether it helps you to have a life verse, it sure helped me to think that I was God's servant, even if I was a secret servant. To be intentional about sharing the gospel with the unbelievers around you. So you're not just going in to pay for your gas anymore. After today, you're going in because you have a message from God for whoever you, like, I could swipe at the pump. I never pay at the pump. I always go in. Like, well, not always. I shouldn't say that. I typically will go in to talk to Brenda. So, and if she's not working, I talk to everyone else. And then to build that Christian support work, and then to have someone that you can mentor. I liked what Laura said about even it could be your little siblings. Like, don't forget there's people in your own family who might need your, and then covering it all in prayer. And I will close us, and speaking of prayer, Thank you guys for letting me come. This has been amazing.
So, thank you so much.
Dear Heavenly Father, it's cool to see how you're at work all over and all over the world and all over right here in the Midwest, bringing people from Illinois and Wisconsin. And I just love that we're all from different churches, we're all from different places, and we are truly able to go from here and spread your word. And I pray that we will leave here motivated and changed, a new creation, and remembering that we no longer regard people from a worldly point of view, but we are new creations, and that we will live that out. I just pray that you'll protect each one of my sisters here from the world and from Satan and from their own heads. Lord, that we can be a good support system when we leave here and be good at taking care of each other. Thank you for all the people who organized this and who cooked for us and who made this financially possible for us. And thank you for this beautiful retreat center. Lord, thank you for Paul and his ministry and just the writing that he left us so that we can spy on what you did in the early church. Please open our eyes to where you are at work so that we can see you as a bigger, more amazing God. And we pray this in Jesus' name.